all know the popular image of artists. Painters, writers, performers. They're creative, but undisciplined. And then there's the scientist. Analytical, methodical, obsessed with accuracy. But whether these cliches are right or wrong, sometimes the artist and the scientist are more alike than you think. Check out this guy.
At the sound of Mario's name, a shiver began in Henderson's chest that scurried over every inch of his skin. He felt as though he'd been heated over glowing coals, then dunked into an ocean-sized bath of ice water.
Meet Karl.
Karl Iagnemma.
Iagnemma.
Iagnemma, yep. It's Italian.
He's a successful writer of fiction, but he's also the same person who's been called one of the top 10 innovative scientists of America. How can he be both? His father was Emidio Iagnemma. Born in Italy, he came to Detroit, and he raised his son to be just like him, an engineer.
I ended up following pretty closely in his footsteps. We shared definitely an interest and a love for physics and math.
I always knew he had a mind like my father. They used to go to computer clubs together, you know, exchange software, and he took drafting classes.
And Karl did some experimenting when his father wasn't looking.
Friends and I would do various experiments with combustion, but nothing too serious. No felonies.
He would like light tennis balls on fire and throw them down the driveway.
Uh-oh. I knew I shouldn't have given you her name.
But all those experiments clearly paid off because Karl went to MIT, where he stayed on to earn his PhD in mechanical engineering and is now a principal research scientist. And today, he's a top member of a team of researchers who are designing robots smart enough to understand their environment. Their algorithms will make it easier for robots to navigate through truly difficult terrain and enable NASA to explore parts of Mars scientists can only dream of reaching today.
Robots right now are pretty dumb. They have a hard time understanding if something is a bush compared to a stone. For wheeled robots, the danger is always that you're gonna drive somewhere, think it's a safe place to drive, and you end up getting stuck. And on Mars, you know, you can't call AAA to tow you out.
As a researcher, I think Karl brings some of the best qualities you'd look for.
Paul Shanker manages the Robotic Space Exploration Technology Program for NASA at the Jet Propulsion Labs in Pasadena. NASA awarded Team MIT more than $1 million for research, overseen day-to-day by Karl.
He's very objective, patient, thoughtful in framing his problems. He also brings passion to his work.
But which work? Let's go back. Meet the other Karl.
Iagnemma. It rhymes with dilemma.
His mother, Patricia Iagnemma, was an English major.
My mother loved literature, so we had books in every room, in the laundry room, in the family room. Karl would lock himself in his room and just read and read and read.
Karl could also write. In fact, his minor at MIT was in writing. Fiction writing, which confused one of his advisors.
He said, oh, I thought you were studying friction.
Hard to believe, but true. Also true is that Karl's short story won a contest for fiction writing, not friction writing, held by Playboy magazine in 1998. And while he was writing his PhD thesis, he started to write his first book.
And I finished it the week after I finished my PhD thesis.
On the Nature of Human Romantic Interaction is meant to sound like a thesis, but don't be fooled. It's an award-winning collection of short stories about characters, many of them scientists, by the way, who fall in and out of love. Karl proves wrong the old assumption that science guys can only write science fiction.
I always refer to him as being whole-brained, using the totality of his brain. I see the dedication that he uses in science apply to his writing.
I don't think I know anybody who's certainly at that high a level in both those areas. It's rare.
Now, it would be easy to congratulate Karl for using more of his brain than most of us, which he clearly does. And it would be a little too easy to marvel at how Karl has managed to succeed at two professions that would seem to be complete opposites, science and fiction writing. But as it turns out, some of the very same skills Karl uses in scientific exploration come to his aid in, well, making stuff up.
In each discipline, you start with a blank page. You start with an idea. There are so many parallels between writing and research. I mean, I view each process as one of increasingly structured creativity.
Okay, so both a writer and a researcher have to be creative. But just ask any writer or any scientist, and they'll tell you creativity is meaningless without discipline. Before you can stare at a blank page or a screen, you must get your butt to the chair. And Karl does it day in and day out.
A lot of writing is just passing the time until something good comes along, and you don't know when that'll be. So to be safe, you should be in that chair as much as you can, on the off chance that, you know, a miracle will happen and the story will be born.
For Karl, it's a lot about patience and discipline. That's an important part of his process, I think. He does his hours, whether he gets 10 pages or one paragraph.
A lot of times I'm in the chair in the evening or in the early morning with my earplugs in so that I can hear all the characters' voices. And just typing either nonsense or typing an outline of a story or typing dialogue that may be good, maybe not any good. But when the story comes along and when you get that germ, that little spark, you know, you feel it and you know it, and that's when the actual story writing process truly starts.
I think he's really efficient. He believes he's inefficient. You know, oh, it takes me so long to write. You write so quickly. And I'm like, dude, I'm not going to a lab trying to figure out how to get the machine to go over the big rock on Mars, okay? I'm having difficulty unloading the dishwasher, okay?
Both writing fiction and doing scientific research are pretty much full-time jobs. They're jobs that occupy you 24 hours a day. You're not a very good friend, lover, husband, wife during this period of months that you're consumed by a scientific problem. You're not very much fun to be around.
I definitely feel that Karl is with me when he's with me, but I do think that he thinks about his work all the time. Since we moved in together, and definitely since Sophia came, he has to be more structured in his work, and he has to set aside hours more. And I think he does that really well, and he does that in a very focused way.
But that structure, those hours, that's a lot of time spent alone.
Solitude is something, as a writer and a researcher, you have to be comfortable with. Writing is, you know, really solitary, and research is kind of its little brother.
When you're solving the equations, you're usually alone, weeks and months. I mean, you will stop to eat meals.
The great untold secret about writing is it's incredibly lonely. You cannot do it, I can't do it anyway, with other people around.
And you have to be okay with that. Some people could never be okay with that. They just wouldn't enjoy the work because they would miss the human contact, or they would miss various aspects of being out in the world.
If I show up at my poker game and I've spent the day writing or trying to write, immediately my poker buddies are like, because I'm all, hey, how you doing, guys? All right, we're gonna get it. And they're like, have you spoken to anyone today? You know, have you talked with anybody? They know that, like, uh-oh, crazy lonely guy, here he is. Well, if we have
the data, it's hardly a rational way to live.
Scientists are passionate about their work. They do it because they cannot not do it.
You get this little rush. You enter into the state where the time just seems to pass, and it's just the best feeling. And that's why you want to go back the next day and do it again, because of that feeling.
But can that feeling carry Karl through two intense careers? Alan Lightman chose to give up his research career in physics to become a successful novelist.
Both the science and the fiction writing are addictions. At some point, if he wants to be a scientist and he wants to be a novelist, one of those powerful forces is going to conquer the other one.
They'd met as first-year graduate students at the Michigan Engineering Institute, two aggressive young theorists who disagreed about Marx and Irish beer, but agreed that mathematics was a game, the most elaborate, wonderful game, like puzzling out riddles posed by God.
Right now, I'm happy doing both. It's tiring, it's fairly exhausting, but it's satisfying. You know, it's kind of the feeling after, I imagine after a runner has completed a long run, it's that pleasant, satisfied exhaustion. That's kind of my constant state. Thank you very much.
Exhausted and passionate, disciplined and humble, Karl Iagnemma will continue to write and calculate using his entire brain. But to his friends, he's just plain old Carl, the walking algorithm for success.
If it were me, if I was doing this stuff, I would be like, dude, I've got a robot going to Mars. What did you do yesterday? And that was before lunch. Then I wrote a great short story in the afternoon. Then I hung out with my beautiful Swedish wife. What'd you do?
If that's not enough, the movie rights to one of Carl's short stories have been optioned by Hollywood to be produced by Brad Pitt.